We are reading from Acts 2, 42 to 47 today, and it says, a generous and growing church. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teachings, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were being performed through the apostles. Now all the believers were together and held all things in common. They sold their possessions and property and distributed the proceeds to all, as any had need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple and broke bread from house to house. They ate their food with joyful and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. Every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord.
Nice one, fam. I like your vibe this morning. I like the appreciative clapping of hands, whooping each other. That's family, right? And that's encouragement. Hey, I want to start by asking you a couple of questions. First, who is your greatest encourager? Who is your greatest encourager? Second question, why this person? Third question, how do they do it? Who's your greatest encourager? Why this person? And how do they do it? Today's theme is being accountable. And I'm asking you these questions because that is what being accountable is all about. It's about encouraging one another. Now, just to make sure that we are on the same page, let me recap what we've been busy with. We call this covenant commitment. So let me remind you of a few things. Firstly, what is covenant commitment? You can read it with me. It is an opportunity to commit to the vision of Fellowship City and to participate in the ministry of Fellowship City in a specific way for the next 12 months. If this is the first time that you hear anything about this, it should actually be clear enough that you can understand what it is all about. Let me show you again what it is that we are asking you to commit to. So next slide here, you commit to supporting the vision of Fellowship City, participating in the ministry and discipleship and fellowship spaces of Fellowship City. You're committing to serving in the church through your time and your talents. You're committing to giving your treasures generously and consistently. And you are committing to being accountable to the church family who are on this journey together. So those are the five things that you commit to. Why do we ask this commitment? Why do we have this process called covenant commitment? Because we want to make disciples. And the way that we make disciples, we show in this triangle. So we say a disciple loves God and loves people. And we say a disciple knows God, commits faithfully, and gives generously. And then we spell out in this triangle how a disciple loves God, loves people, knows God, commits faithfully, and gives generously of. All of our commitments are bound together in this discipleship journey. That's the end goal. That's what we want you to be. A disciple who loves God and loves people. I said that we have information available for you, both online and physically there in the back of the building. And I do want to encourage you to please catch up on the sermons if you missed it, because this is the very last one in this series. And like I said, we have 1 week to go, and then covenant commitment sign up will close. You saw that we had the same teaching text over the last 7 weeks, which was Acts 2, verses 42 to 47. I encouraged you to see if you can memorize it. I hope that you at least try to. Now, before we jump into our teaching text, let me pray for us. Lord Jesus, we still have the taste of your love in our mouths. And we know that that means that new life has been given to us, that we became part of your family, and that we can now sit under your word as your children, as your followers, as people who are being made into your image, and that we can learn from you. It's amazing for us to know that this isn't just a book with words written on a page, but that it is your living word that can penetrate every fiber of our being. And that's what we pray for this morning, is that you would speak to us through your word, that we would be encouraged, that we would be edified, that we would be exhorted, that we would be convicted, and that we would be transformed as we engage the word. I pray for a sound mind for all of us now as we hear these words, for open ears and open hearts. Let your spirit minister to us, Lord Jesus, and may I only say the words that you want me to say, all for the glory of your name. We pray that in your name. Amen. Okay, so Acts 2 tells us about the birthday of the church. The Holy Spirit descended on 120 people in what was called the upper room. And then it records the growth process of this very young and very first church. And it also tells us in Acts chapter 2 that on the day of Pentecost, about 3,000 people believed the gospel, they repented of their sins, and they were baptized. And then we see Acts 2, 42 to 47, and I want to show you two highlights. So we see that they devoted themselves to something, the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and to prayer. And then the last verse will be our focus for today, and that is, every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. So you'll know over the last few weeks, we highlighted certain parts of this teaching text, and then we dug a little bit deeper to see what it means. So today our focus will be on verse 47. Here's what I want you to notice. God did not add people to the church without saving them. Do you see it? And God also didn't save people without adding them to the church. These two things go together. We can say that there's a union of personal salvation and church membership. They go together. Two sides of the same proverbial coin. And that's also the pattern that we see in the New Testament. As I was prepping for the sermon this week, I realized that I got saved 19 years ago, and I've been part of the church for 19 years. Like, as I was typing this, I went, my word, I can't remember being a Christian and not being part of the church. Got saved on a Wednesday evening, had the gospel explained to me on a Thursday, and then I went to church that Sunday, and I went to home cell that next Wednesday. And that's been the pattern for the last 19 years. So I actually don't know how to be a Christian without being part of the church. And I remember going the first Sunday, hearing the gospel, loving it, singing all the songs and praying all the prayers, and then next Sunday there was a call to action, so I went, well, they're probably speaking to me because I'm not serving yet, so yes, here I am, let me start serving. That's a New Testament pattern. It resonates deeply with me, so I am extremely biased because I don't know how else to be a Christian. That's been the truth also through church history. Whenever biblical Christianity has been practiced in the history of the church, Christians have had a very high view of church. Now, unfortunately, you guys know that this is not the case today in the time we live in. We have people today, both believers and unbelievers, who question the necessity of the church, and who question the relevance of the church, and who question the importance of the local church. Our generation, or this time we live in, we've created a new category that biblical and historical Christianity never even would think of, and that is so-called unchurched Christians. Unchurched Christians. Cyprian, who was a church father or a historical figure in the church, he said, outside the church, there is no salvation. Yet, today we have something like an unchurched Christian. So in other words, if you ask the question, who needs the church? The answer is, whoever wants to be saved. Think about it. This is the place where you will hear the good news and the implications of the good news for your life over and over and over again. So if you want to know how to be saved, this is the spot. And if you want to know how to live saved, this is the spot. No salvation outside the church, said Cyprian. Now, very important. This does not mean that church membership and church attendance and church participation can save you, okay? Don't step into that trap. That's not what I'm saying. We know that God forgives our sins, listen to the rhyme, by grace alone, through faith alone, because of Jesus Christ alone. We know that. Here's the amazing thing. God has made the church, this one included, Fellowship City, the stewards of this good news of Jesus Christ. Think about it. Here you go. Here's the message. Here's the gospel. Now, use it to accomplish your mission. Use it in a way that my mission that I've given you will be fulfilled. That's why the church matters. Jesus entrusted us with this message. So this union of personal salvation and church membership is the pattern of the New Testament. And if we, fam, are a Bible-believing, Bible-teaching church, then we have to believe this. And we have to live accordingly. That means that we live as we, not me. This means that I am a participating member of a local church so that I can be a healthy, growing, fruitful Christian. I am a member of a church, or I'm committing to a church, so that I can live as someone who is saved. If we believe this, then it means that we are part of a family in which we, listen to this, in which we each other. See what I did there? 59 commands in the New Testament says, do this to each other. What's the biggest? Love each other. Do you know what's another biggie? Encourage each other. That is what accountability is all about. Just in case you haven't read our booklet, you haven't opened up the PDF, or you haven't signed up for covenant commitment, let me give you a sneak peek into our sign-up form. Read it with me. You'll find these sentences in our sign-up form at the last section, where you will commit to being accountable. See how we phrase it. We need to encourage and help one another to remain faithful to the commitments and decisions we made for the next 12 months. Who wouldn't want encouragement? And who wouldn't want help? And we're using these words because accountability doesn't mean we need to be punished and called out and shamed for our reluctance to stick to our commitments. That's not what we're saying. We're saying we want to encourage one another and we need help. Saying yes to being accountable means saying yes to receiving this encouragement and help from people you are journeying with, the leaders of our ministries and our elders. And then we ask, will you be accountable to your brothers and sisters in Christ for the commitments you made for the next 12 months? It shouldn't scare you. It should excite you because you're not alone. And encouragement and help is the name of the game for accountability. It's not pointing fingers and shaming and scoffing. Think about it. I walk and I stumble. Accountability is coming alongside and helping you up. And showing you the way again and journeying with you for the rest of the way. It's not about pointing and laughing, fam. That's what we're asking you to commit to. If you are baptized, in some way or form, you made a commitment at the day of your baptism. If you were baptized as a child, when you confirmed your faith in front of a church, you also made a commitment. Can I remind you what we actually ask people who we baptize in this church? The last two questions before we baptize someone in there. It reads like this. Do you commit to actively participating in the life of the church? And do you submit to the help of your fellow brothers and sisters when you stumble in your journey of faith? That is a commitment to being accountable. So what we're asking you now during covenant commitment isn't new, fam. It's just a moment for you to renew this commitment. Because if you're a baptized believer, you made that commitment at the day of your baptism. And this is a moment to say, I need to revise and renew this. Why all of this? Well, because of the gospel. Remember, fam, our leap of faith, or us coming to faith, is a response to something. It was right in front of us today. The body and the blood. The price Jesus paid for us. The life He offers us and gives us. The transformation He brings by saving us from our sin, freeing us from the slavery of sin, pouring His Spirit out on us, and then transforming us into His image. All of that together is called the gospel. We hear it, we sing it, we pray it, and we preach it, and then at some point you decide, I am going to respond to it. And we know that you don't have to work to get it. It's by grace alone, through faith alone, because of Jesus Christ alone. It starts with ABC, admitting, believing, and confessing. It's so easy. And here's the great news. It starts with ABC, and it ends with, not XYZ, eternity. That's the amazing thing about the church and about the good news. Jesus did everything for you. He gives you the gift. You take a grip by taking a leap of faith, and then your life changes forever. And it will never, ever end. That's the good news. And when we respond to it and we come to faith, it changes everything about everything for us. And then we make these kind of commitments because we want to live like saved people. I can actually stop here and say amen. And I actually believe that that would be enough. What I do want to do though this morning is I just want to spend time answering one question. And that is, what am I accountable for? What am I accountable for? Here's your four answers. My confession of faith. My commitment to the family of faith, my obedience to the word, and my preparation for the day. Are you with me? Where do we find this? Well, we find this in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 21 to 25. So let me read Hebrews 10 for us. Read it with me. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us... We'll see that three times. Draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed in pure water. Let us hold on to the confession of our hope without wavering, since he who promised is faithful. And let us consider one another in order to provoke love and good works, not neglecting to gather together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging each other, and all the more as you see the day approaching. My confession of faith, my commitment to the family of faith, my obedience to the word, my preparation for the day. Let's go. My confession of faith. Remember, the book of Hebrews was written to a group of what we would call at-risk Jewish Christians. They were tempted to turn away from Jesus. Why? Because they faced severe persecution. It was hard to be a Christian in that time. And the author of Hebrews writes to them, and he encourages them, and he challenges them to persevere in the faith. And he uses one word to challenge and encourage them, and that is better, saying to them, what you have in Jesus is far better than anything you ever had, or than anything you think you could ever have. Jesus is the best. That's the point he makes. And then, in chapter 10, verses 19 to 21, which we didn't read now, the writer summarizes the argument that he's been making, and that is that Jesus is our great high priest. He's the perfect atoning sacrifice. He established a new way for us to live, and now we have this life through his own blood. And then he says, think about this, the good news that I just explained. And he said, then respond. And your response should be to hold fast to Christ, like hold on. And then he mentions these three, let us, let us, let us. One relates to God, verse 22. One relates to self, verse 23. And the one relates to other believers in verse 24. So, since Jesus did all of this for us, then let us. And the first thing he mentions is your confession of faith. Look at it. With a true heart in full assurance. Remember, there was a day that you said that you believe this. Do you still believe this? Because this hasn't changed. So your confession also shouldn't. You know what I mean? Like, I believe that I believe that I believe that I know that I know that I know. He says, since Jesus did all of that, let's have full assurance of our faith. And if we doubt, then we seek full assurance again. Do you guys understand that? Somehow Christians are allergic to the word doubt because we think it's a sin. If you doubt and you have questions, welcome to being a human. And if you doubt and you have questions, welcome to the church. Figure it out. Seek answers. Wrestle it through. Pray it through with your brothers and sisters. Be open and vulnerable and honest about it so that you can have full assurance again. The worst thing that could happen to a Christian is having doubt and questions, and then you slowly moonwalk your way out of the church because you think that it's a shame. How will you get full assurance again? Look for the answers here. That's what we're here for. That's why we preach every Sunday. Do you know what I mean? So full assurance, and then your confession of hope. This should give you hope. Do you have hope? Because if you don't have hope, then confess your faith again so that you can have hope. See what I mean? Because your confession of faith shouldn't only give you full assurance of your salvation, it should also give you hope. The author of Hebrews says, hold on. Keep going. Stay committed. Be faithful. What do you say to a person who's ready to give up on Jesus? According to this text, do you know what you should say to him or her? Commit. Come. Stay. Why? Because church membership, corporate worship, Christian fellowship, all the things that we've mentioned, are the primary means through which God's preserving grace sustains us. That is how we keep going. That is how God sustains us. Your faith in the truth of the gospel will not be able to stand without the church in your life. It's not how the New Testament pattern goes. It's not how Jesus wanted it. Let's put it to the test. Ask anyone who's walked away from church, how are you doing now? I can guarantee you, not a single person will say, nah, things are running like a jet. I'm growing, I am bearing fruit, Jesus is revealing himself to me, I am really enjoying my Bible study, I'm praying all the prayers, dude, it is fruit on fruit on fruit, it's a bountiful harvest. I've never asked a brother or sister who's walked away, how are they doing now? And then they tell me they're doing better. And some of you have gone through those seasons. Now I'm in the church and now I'm not in the church. Just think back about how miserable your life is if you're not in the church. It's just how it is. Not because I say church is cool, but because that's the way that Jesus designed it. It's like a fire. Every piece of wood in the fire will burn brightly and really, really warm if they're all put together. If you want to snuff out a flame, take a piece of wood out and put it somewhere on its own. It's going to lose heat. It's going to start smoking. It'll smolder and it'll die. And the rest of the fire will burn brightly. I don't know if you've ever watched some antelope walk around in the wild, right? Little herd of impalas, loving it. And then there's this one impala who feels, I'm way too cool and I want to do me. And he wanders off, leopard pops, he gone, dead. Why? Because he's alone and he's isolated. So he's an easy target, an easy prey. William Willimon, he's an old retired guy who's written 60 books. He says, the gospel does not make sense without the church that makes it make sense. That's a ripper. That's a beauty. I mean, if you've published 60 books, you'll come up with gems like these. The gospel does not make sense without the church that makes it make sense. Your confession of faith is a response to the gospel, and that is why you have to be accountable to it. For it, that's why I have to be accountable for it. Do I still believe the gospel? It's a question I need to ask every single day. It's a question I need to have me asked of me every Sunday and every time we gather. So that's the first thing you're accountable for, your confession of faith. Second thing, your commitment to the family of faith. Let me show you a picture. These trees are called the California redwood trees. That's a human being standing in front of the tree. The highest or tallest and oldest trees in the world. They stand over 100 meters and they are said to be over 2,500 years old. Now, if you look at the height of that tree, you might think that it has a massive root system drilling deep into the earth and going very, very wide. It does not. Compared to other trees, redwoods don't have many roots, and also their roots don't go very deep. Yet they've stood for centuries. Do you know why? Because their roots are all intertwined and interwoven with each other. Fascinating, huh? So, if the wind blows, the redwoods stand. Why? Because they are linked and locked to each other, holding one another up. That's the way that Christians stand against the storms of life that assault our faith. If your faith is being assaulted by the storms of life, you'll stay standing if you are intertwined and interwoven with other believers. We will keep you up, I promise. That's how it works. The Apostles' Creed, the oldest confession of the church, says we believe in the communion of the saints. You can't say that you believe in God the Father and in His Son Jesus Christ and in the Holy Spirit and in the one church, but not in the communion of the saints. I don't like those people. They're boring. And they're different than I am, and they tell the same stories over and over, and I can spend my time differently. That's not how it works. You confess that you believe in God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and in the communion of the saints. Look at verse 24 again. It says, let us consider one another. The verb consider means to perceive clearly, to understand fully, or to consider closely. In Hebrews 3 verse 1, the writer says, therefore, holy brothers, you who share in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession. The writer of Hebrews says you must consider or set your mind on the person and the work of Jesus Christ if your faith is to be strong, stable, and secure. And then it says we need to set our minds on one another continuously, repeatedly. If you want to read this in Greek, it says, and let us constantly consider one another. So just as we as Christians are always to be thinking about Jesus, we are always to be thinking about one another. Why? Because we are a family. It's what we is. I know that's horrible English, but it's great theology. It's what we is. And that is primarily, essentially, and ultimately a family. What holds us together is not geography or our social standing or organizational structures or an institution or programs. What holds us together is the fact that we care for one another and the fact that we are concerned for one another and the fact that we have compassion for one another and the fact that that concern and care and compassion results in us actually saying stuff to one another. Encouraging one another, making decisions for the better of each other, and expressing that love in actions towards one another. Let me meet you with this one. 1 John 3 verse 14 says, we know that we passed out of death into life because we love the brothers. Woof! If you don't love the brothers, you're not a Christian. Well, and sisters, no free passes then. That's what John says. Whoever does not love abides in death. So true Christian love will not only lead us to attend and participate in the ministry of the church, it will also lead us to prayerfully and compassionately consider the needs of each other, consider the growth of each other, even when we are not physically together. Fam, if you think of someone, just send them a message. Say, how's it? Checking in. You can even just do the wave smiley and the hug smiley. Just do it! Because someone will know someone is carrying a concern for me, even though I'm not physically with them. See, we've got Christians in this day that would tell you, hey, listen, I read books. I watch The Chosen and some other Christian telly, and I listen to podcasts. Doesn't that count? It counts, but it's helpful supplements to what you receive by being a participating member of a church. Supplements cannot become substitutes. Do you see it? Supplements to your Christian diet cannot become substitutes for the real stuff that is made up, or for the real stuff that makes up the Christian life. And that is membership and participation and corporate worship and fellowship with other believers. Let me show you a few verses. Proverbs 18, verse 1. Whoever isolates himself seeks his own. He breaks out against all sound judgment. If I have to translate that now into South African English, I'll say, whoever isolates himself is really dumb. Because that's what it says. 1 Corinthians 10, 24. Let no one seek his own good, but the good of his neighbor. Philippians 2, verse 4. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. I need to be held accountable for my commitment to the family of faith. Look at the rest of verse 24. It says, to provoke love and good works. The church is to be marked by these two things, love and good works. And you and I know that love and good works don't come automatically. It asks for something. Do you know what it needs? It needs provocation. It needs a little bit of irritation. You can't fulfill this calling on your own. Someone needs to provoke you to do these things so that it can be done through you. Now that's an interesting word, provoke. Look at the last part of verse 24. The word means a sudden outbreak of sickness or symptoms or spasms. It usually has a very negative connotation. So it can also be translated as irritation or exasperation. Let me tell you a story about my comrades a few weeks ago. I had a hamstring cramp on 70 kilometers. The first 70 kilometers went really, really well. I was enjoying my run. And then all of the sudden, this left hammy went, dang! And it's undeniable, fam. It is there. Something caused a reaction. There was an irritation and a constant provocation and a constant exasperation until my leg said, enough. And then it reacted. And when it reacted, it was undeniable. It was there. The only other time that this term is used in the New Testament, it is used negatively, and that is where it explains that Paul and Barnabas had a disagreement over whether to take John Mark with them in Acts chapter 15. And there it says, and there arose a sharp disagreement. There arose a cramp, and they separated from each other. Okay, so Luke uses it in its negative sense. The writer of Hebrews uses it in its positive sense. But I do think that we have to, just for a moment, pause and consider the negative connotations. Because here's what it says. If need be, we should irritate one another to love and good works. That's what it says. Proverbs 27:17. Iron sharpens iron, and one man sharpens another. Have you ever sharpened something? Sharpening does not happen by hugging. Sharpening doesn't happen by caressing. Sharpening doesn't happen by pampering. You sharpen something by taking iron and getting another piece of iron and literally rubbing it the wrong way. That's how you sharpen something. I don't take my sharpener and my knife and go, can you two guys just hug it out? No! Iron against iron. It's a hardcore process. But once that knife comes out, my mouth, it can cut through Gouda cheese. Just like that. Have you ever tried to cut Gouda with a blunt knife? Oh my word. It's like trying to cut a bouncing ball. Anyway, I'm hungry. How about you? I don't know. Let me show you this quote from H.B. Charles. He says, your true friends are not the people who always agree with you. Co-sign your agenda and stay out of your way. Your best friends are the ones who make you better. That involves times when friends put a supportive arm around your shoulder and times when they put a scolding finger in your face. You need both the comfort of tender love and the confrontation of tough love. You need to be with brothers and sisters in Christ who think enough of you to stir you up to love and good works. That's a rubber. I've heard recently that rugby is described as 30 men on a field in desperate need of rest, being watched by 50,000 people in the stands in desperate need of exercise. Why? Because it's a spectator sport. Church is not a spectator sport. Church is not a space where you show up, you receive the ministry of others, you give an offering, you greet a few people, and then you go home thinking and talking about how this service either did it for you or didn't do it for you. No, fam. Church is a place where everyone plays. And that's why we need to be accountable to our commitment to the family of faith. Let's look at the third one. I need to be accountable, or I am accountable for, my obedience to the word. Look at verse 25. It teaches us that if you are a follower of Jesus, your presence and your participation, specifically in corporate worship like this, are mandatory. Not neglecting to gather together, but encouraging each other. Now, this verse commands us to not forsake Christian assembly, which means that it assumes that you should be committed to Christian assembly. Do you see it? So it tells us, don't stay away. Lean in, big and small. Now the word neglecting is actually very emphatic and very intense because it means totally abandoning or utterly forsaking. This term is used in Matthew 27:46 and Mark 15:34, where Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Paul uses this word in 2 Corinthians 4. He says he's persecuted, but he's not forsaken. The writer of Hebrews uses it in chapter 13, verse 5, and says, the promise of God says that I will never leave you nor forsake you. So the writer uses it in our text to tell us not to forsake, not to abandon, and not to desert the gatherings of the church. Said simply, everyone in this church should be marked present when we assemble on the Lord's Day. And always when you talk about this, people ask the question, what if I'm not around? That's the wrong question, because the answer is rhetorical, and it's a given. Do you know what the question is? What if I am around? That's the question. Now remember, in Hebrews, the people were missing gatherings. Why? Because every time they gathered, there was the possibility that they could die. Every time they gathered, there was the possibility that they would be executed. That's why they didn't want to come. Them staying away from the gatherings had nothing to do with what I would call our desires this day that is sinful, selfish, silly, and superficial. All of those are reasons that we come up with for missing church, missing D group, missing city group, missing growth group, missing men's breakfast, missing all of these things that we have at our church. Let me just be honest with you as your pastor. It is very easy and very tempting to miss church stuff. But you never experience that same temptation to miss other stuff. Do you text your boss on a Monday and say, I'm tired? Do you? Do you miss a meeting and text people 15 minutes later and say, hey fam, not gonna make it? Do you lie in on a Thursday morning and go, I don't think I'm going to go to work today. It's really cold outside. You don't. Here's the shocking thing. You don't even miss your Saturday hobbies. You get up at 6:30 when it's 6 degrees to go and walk a trail with someone. But you can't come to church because on Sunday, oh, everything hurts. And I'm so sick and I've got all these other things that I should do. And church is such a mountain ahead of me. And then on Monday you get up like this. It's temptation, fam. And it's lies from the devil that's keeping you isolated. Impala, on the side, leopard pops up, you're gone. Stop neglecting the gatherings. You're being lied to by the enemy. It's a lie on a Sunday morning to think worship is probably going to suck. The kids are probably going to be very noisy. Raina is going to preach so long. Coffee might be done when I'm there. I'm going to have leaves sticking to my shoes when I get into my car. We might have load shedding. All of that is lies. Well, except the fact that I preach for long. But I am trying to work on that. Okay. You're being tricked. You're being kept away from growth and formation. You're going to grow cold. I heard a story about an old guy who lost his sight and his hearing and continued to go to church. And then someone asked him, why do you continue to come to church if you can't see anything or you can't hear anything? And the old guy said, it's because I want to show everybody whose side I'm on. Hey? Isn't that a beautiful story? That ought to be our attitude. Your presence and your participation in our ministry and your accountability to the people in our ministries ought to show your family, your friends, your neighbors, your co-workers, and even the principalities and the powers of this earth whose team you are on. Your participation is also mandatory. So it's not only your presence, but it's also your participation. Note, look at verse 25. The contrast is between not neglecting and actually encouraging. The contrast is not between showing up and not showing up. Do you guys see it? The contrast is between not neglecting and actually, when you are here, doing something that will encourage someone else. So it's about more than your presence. It's also about your participation. And that means that some of us have come into the habit of actually forsaking the assembly or neglecting the assembly even though we attend. I think I'm about to offend you. Sorry. You neglect the meeting when you show up late and you leave early every week. Because then you come for you, you don't come for others. You're not encouraging anyone. You're slipping in and slipping out. You neglect the meeting when you come to the meeting and then you hang around outside and you don't come in. Everything we do in here is designed to help you to encounter God so that you can be encouraged, so that you can encourage other people. Catching some sun with someone and chatting about football won't encourage you or him or her. I don't know if ladies ever talk about football, but hey. We live in an egalitarian society. Do you know what I mean? So you might. You might. You neglect the meeting when you show up with a bad attitude. When you show up arms crossed, not wanting fellowship with anyone. If you are inhospitable, if you're critical, if you are irrelevant. You neglect the meeting when you sit and sleep. When you walk around during the meeting. When you talk during the meeting. When you pass notes during the meeting or you do something else. You're never going to be encouraged and you're never going to encourage someone else if you do it like that. God demands our presence. He demands our participation in all of our gatherings and spaces. I read this analogy that says Christians are like hitchhikers. Think about it. A hitchhiker says with his thumb, you buy the car, you pay for the repairs, you pay for the upkeep and the insurance, you fill the car with petrol, I'll ride with you, and if you have an accident, you're all on your own. I might even sue you. That's the way many people treat the church, fam. You worship, you serve, you give, you pray, you support, and if you do it well enough, hey, I'll come along for the ride. But don't expect anything from me. And know that if things don't suit me, I'll criticize, I'll complain, I'll bail, and then my thumb is out for a better ride. We can't be like that. Not this family. I submit to you that it's not God's will for us to be a church-hopping hitchhiker. God wants us to commit and to participate as a member of a local church. It's in His Word. And that's why I need to be accountable for my obedience to the word. Last one. I need to be accountable for my preparation for the day. Okay, let's recap. My confession of faith, my commitment to the family of faith, my obedience to the word, my preparation for the day. Look at the very last sentence. All the more as you see the day approaching. You might feel that we meet too often. I would like to submit to you that the Bible says that we should meet as much as we possibly can. Why? Because we need this encouragement. Look at it, look at it. Hebrews 3, verse 12 to 13. Watch out, brothers and sisters, so that there won't be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. Oh my word, that means I have a heart that can be evil and unbelieving if I don't watch out. What's the remedy? Verse 13. But encourage each other daily. While it is still called today. Like do it now. So that none of you is hardened by sin's deception. Oh my word. My heart can be evil. My heart can be unbelieving. My heart can be hardened by sin's deception. The only answer is daily encouragement. I wish that we could have church every day. Ooh, I would love to preach every day. Let's be honest. We need this Christian exhortation. Why? Because as we see the day of the Lord's return drawing near, we need to exhort one another. We need to encourage one another. And we need to admonish one another to remain faithful, because He is coming. We say that every week in our gospel-centered definition. The return of Jesus Christ. Let me hit you with this stat. There was a survey that reported, check this, that 66% of American Christians believe that Jesus will return. Okay, so two-thirds of American Christians said, yes, He will return. But of those two-thirds, only half actually attended a church. So you've got three-thirds, one-third doesn't attend church and doesn't believe that Jesus will come back. A second-third says, I attend church. And the third-third says, I believe He'll come back, but it doesn't really bother me. That is a contradiction. Because do you know what you'll face when He comes back? Judgment and account. You will give an account. There's going to be a day, and that day is coming. And the New Testament tells us, as that day is coming closer, that more and more people will start walking away from the faith. And they shouldn't. That is why we should consistently speak to each other and encourage each other and strengthen each other to persevere. Look at the last verse. All the more as you see the day approaching. All the more. I'm exhorting you today. I should exhort you more next week because that day is 1 week closer. And then I should exhort you more the week after because then that day is another week closer. As that day comes closer, we have to encourage each other to be ready for that day. And do you know how you do it? You come alongside each other and you argue with and you argue for. That's what the word encouragement means. In 1 John 2, verse 1, John describes Jesus as this encourager. They use the word advocate in the English translation. In John 14, verse 16, he describes the Holy Spirit as that encourager, as that helper, as that comforter. So just as Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit come alongside us to help us, we as brothers and sisters in Christ are to come alongside one another to encourage one another. The Greek word is paraklete, parakletos. Think of it as a pair of cleats, a pair of boots. It helps you to keep your footing. It helps you not to slip. It helps you to change direction. It helps you to move forward. That's what encouraging is. And that's what we should do with each other. Come alongside one another, hip to hip, and speaking words of encouragement as we journey there. That's what the Holy Spirit does to us. One more comrade story. In Maritzburg, 3 kilometers to go. I was taking a slowish run because I didn't want to cramp again. The lady who won the 50 plus category just passed me. I congratulated her. I had a conversation with a guy on the mountain bike with her, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I stood completely still. Whole hammy from the bottom all the way to where it plants into the glute. Cramping like crazy. And I stood still and I worked through the cramp, and there was a lady sitting there on her camp chair. She was supporting people. Nice one, guys. Nice one, JP. Let's go, Benoni Northerns. Westville, how's it, man? Reno, Bontur. I like, that's what they do. So she was sitting there on her camp chair, legs folded, and I started to cramp up. Fam, I'm telling you, 2 seconds. She gave 2 massive leaps, and she was right next to me. Unbelievable moment. She sat there, ran up. Ran up with ice, and as I stood there, she was right next to me, and we had our names and our numbers. So she said, "Reno, what do you need?" And I said to her, "Just rub my hamstring with that ice, please." And she was on her knees next to me, going, giving that hammy a rub. And when she was done, like we were against each other, I took the ice and I rubbed it over my face and over my arms, and I kept going. That is what encouragement is. It wouldn't have helped if she just sat there and went, "Ah, tough one, Rana. Sorry, my butt." Wouldn't have worked. She was right next to me. And I got going again. And I didn't cramp for the last 3 Ks. And I was in. That's encouragement, fam. Last example. Have you guys ever been to a gym? Anyone? Please raise your hand. There's something in the gym called spotting. Have you guys seen it? So someone is on the bench. They have a barbell. That barbell has weights on. And then someone stands really close to them around their head. And it seems like that someone is fully in the movement, right? Supporting the bench press. Breathing with. Going down. Tup, tup, and coming up. And going down. And coming up. It's called spotting. Anyone who's ever been to a gym would tell you that spotting makes you almost twice as strong as you'll be on your own. Because you've got confidence that someone is helping you just that little bit. And you'll see that I only use 2 fingers, right? Especially for the gents. No, don't help me too much. I've seen guys with legs like this and arms like this, and they take 1 finger. Okay, Baliki, let's go. But that 1 finger makes you incredibly strong. Because there's someone watching out for me as I work and as I get ready and as I drive towards this goal. I have that feeling that someone is in there with it. Someone is in there with me. Someone is helping me to achieve that goal. That's what accountability is for. That's why we ask you to commit to be accountable. And you'll be accountable for your confession of faith, your commitment to the family of faith, your obedience to the word, and your preparation for the day. Will you be accountable to your brothers and sisters in Christ for the commitments you made for the next 12 months? Amen. I want to give us an opportunity to respond. I want to map out some responses. Okay, how should we respond? Fam, 4 things. Firstly, I think if your confession of faith has wavered, if you struggle to believe the gospel, if you don't have hope in the gospel anymore, today is the day to say, "I reconfess this." I also know that that's not good English, but it's great theology. Maybe today is the day in which you reconfess that you actually believe this gospel we preach. That's the first thing. Second thing, maybe today is a moment where you need to acknowledge that I need and that we need you. And that you need us. Because that's who we is. Maybe today is a day for you where you return back to the family of faith. Hey, look, fam, I know that we're a ragtag bunch of people, but we're all brothers and sisters. I can't tell you how much joy it gives me when we have communion to sit here and to just look at all of you and go, she's my sister, she's my sister, she's my sister, he's my brother, and I'm their brother. It's a mind-boggling reality. Maybe that's your response today, is to say, I'm returning to the family of faith. Maybe your response today is repentance, because you haven't been obedient to the word. I mean, that's not a difficult question. Have you obeyed the Bible or not? And don't give me a, well, that's a great question. Thank you for asking. It's either yes or no. Have you been obeying the word or not? Because if you haven't, then repent. Maybe today that's your response. And lastly, maybe if you think about your preparation for the day, maybe today is a return back to spotting someone else and encouraging them, or actually being spotted, saying, I need you to encourage me because I can't do this alone. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for the gift of faith. Thank you for the leap of faith. Thank you that it's as easy as ABC. Thank you that it gives us great hope and that it gives us full assurance. I pray for my brothers and sisters now who need to reconfess this today, that you will give them that full assurance and that you'll restore hope in their hearts and souls. I pray for us as a family of faith that we would be like redwoods, that we would be intertwined and interwoven with one another so that we can withstand the storms of life. I pray that we would be present and that we would participate, and that we would do what it is that you ask of us in this church. And for everyone not loving the family as they should, Lord Jesus, give us grace and fill our hearts with your love so that we can also share that love with one another. We've been disobedient, Lord Jesus, and we confess that, and we repent. We turn from this way where you would speak to us, we would hear it, and then we would not do it. And we turn towards you, the author and the perfecter of our faith, the one who shows the way, the one who gives us the grace and the power to be obedient to you. We know, Lord Jesus, that you said, if you love me, you'll keep my commands. So we love you, so please help us then to keep your commands. And lastly, Lord Jesus, I pray that this church would be an encouraging church, that we would encourage one another, that we would be encouraged, and that we would be like that gym partner spotting someone else. All of this, Lord Jesus, so that your mission could be fulfilled through us, so that you can be glorified, so that your body can move, so that more people can come to faith, so that we can see lives transformed. May it be that we can fulfill this mission, Lord Jesus. We pray that in your name. Amen.